Just let me hear some of that rock and roll music. Any old way you choose it. It's got a backbeat, you can't lose it. Any old time you use it. It's gotta be rock roll music. If you wanna rock with me. If you wanna rock with me. I took my loved one over.
Welcome to One Record, a festival to celebrate and explore the black music of the city, historical and contemporary. My name is Paul Gallagher, I'm from National Museums Liverpool, and we're proud to host this In Conversation, which is about the black musical influences of the Beatles. And I'm delighted to welcome Peter Hooton and Mark Lewisohn. Peter is the founder, singer-songwriter with The Farm. He's also co-founder, editor of The End, and he's an accomplished author too. And he's written two really good books about football, When Football Was Football and The Boot Room Boys from 2018. And even as a biased Evertonian, I have to admit they're great. Peter is also a member of Liverpool City Region Music Board and he's chair of the city's Beatles Legacy Group. And I'm a member of both. And through those conversations with Peter over the years, and more recently, we've been talking about the Beatles, obviously. We've been talking about black music. And really recently, we've been talking about those influences. Inevitably, Mark's book, Tune In, comes in all the time. And we thought, wouldn't it be great to have a really good chat with Mark and tell us more about that story? Mark himself is also a very accomplished author. His most recent books include Recording Sessions, The Complete Beatles Chronicle, and he's co-authored The Beatles London. He's also partway through a three-volume historical trilogy, The Beatles, After All These Years. And the first part of that trilogy, Tune In, came out in 2013. Mark has also been an advisor on many projects, including National Museum Liverpool's film project In the Town Where I Was Born, which is a Beatles immersive experience in the Museum of Liverpool. So welcome to you both.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mark, we feel really, really guilty that we're dragging you away from writing the second element of the book, but there's so much we want to ask you. So we're really grateful for your time. And one of the lovely things about the Beatles, I think, is that I think for so many, the Beatles' musical influences and the black musical influences are known. For some, it's a bit hidden. For others, there's a hint of apocryphal stories. But what the loveliest thing about the Beatles, I think, is that they're very open about those musical influences and are almost the best champions of it themselves. But the story goes back before they were even Beatles, doesn't it? It goes back to the time when they were teenagers and they first heard rock and roll and rhythm and blues, and it changed their lives forever, didn't it?
Well, you know, the Beatles have been around now since the 1960s, which is a very long time, and now in the 2020s. So it's kind of not always easy for people to grasp the fact that when they were growing up, when they were kids, when they were infants, there was no rock and roll. I mean, it's been around now for so long that we're all accepting of it constantly. But it simply didn't exist. And there wasn't a hole. They didn't realize that they didn't have this thing. They just didn't have it. And they grew up listening to the BBC Light program, and there would be novelty tunes and popular songs and jazz and classical, of course. And then they were the perfect age between, say, well, George Harrison would have been 13 when rock and roll came out in 1956. 56 is the key year. John, the eldest, was 16 that year, 15 to 16. So they were the age. I always think when you're about 14, that's when you most consume something like that, because you're beginning to break away from parental influences and want to find something of your own. And along came Elvis Presley and changed their lives overnight. And that coincided also with skiffle music, which we tend not to think about very much, but skiffle music, which was gave them the encouragement to get up and play, even though they weren't very good. That too is black in origin. I mean, it's the origins of skiffle is 1920s Chicago rent party music. So if you lived in a tenement building in Chicago and you were black in the 1920s, you had either no job or a poorly paid job and you couldn't afford the rent, you would have a party and play music and people would come along and somehow or other the money would be scraped together and you would be able to pay the rent. So skiffle and rock and roll fused together in these boys' minds at the perfect age in 1956-57, and that was it. And they became, their lives were completely, the course of their lives were changed completely by music that was absolutely entirely of black origin. So the key moment, I suppose, really, is in 1957 when John Lennon and Paul McCartney meet for the first time of significance anyway, when they actually stop and speak and when Paul sees John playing guitar, and that's in Waltham in the south end of Liverpool. And the thing that struck Paul was that John was playing this record here, or this song on this record. I don't know if you can see that. Come Go With Me by the Del Vikings on the London American label. That's a 10-inch 78, very breakable. Yeah. Now, that was a really obscure record. It had come out in Britain. That is a British pressing I just held up, but no one knew it, really. I mean, it wasn't in the charts, and it certainly wasn't being played on the BBC. It was only heard, really, on Radio Luxembourg, because Decca, the British record company that owned London, bought airtime and could play whatever records they wanted to play in their own show. So Paul knew that song, and John knew that song, but almost nobody else did. So it wasn't only the fact that John was up there playing his guitar, it was the fact that he was playing that, and that Paul knew it.
Yeah.
Because they were both connoisseurs of this extraordinarily rare, specialized music that was coming out of the States. And that was the turn on for Paul. It's just like, and the fact that John was, who hadn't heard it clearly, you know, Radio Luxembourg, the sound used to ebb and flow away on the medium wave. And John hadn't heard the lyrics. He was never that brilliant at remembering lyrics anyway. So he was making up his own. And Paul knew enough about the record to know that the ones John was singing weren't the real ones, but they were other ones. They were clever ones. And that John made a huge impression on Paul. Had John been playing some Doris Day number, or you know, something, you know, Guy Mitchell or whatever, something else from the period, it may not have had the same impact on Paul. But because of them playing this rare bit of gold from Pittsburgh in Pennsylvania, that was it. That they connected. Well, love, love it, darling, come and go with me, come with me, baby, under sea. Bit of research into the Del Vikings. They were five black USAF, US Air Force servicemen in Pittsburgh. But because they were servicemen, they were often flying in and out. You know, they weren't always on base at the same time. And the personnel of the Del Vikings kept changing as a result. And along the way of all those changes, they became racially integrated, which was very rare for those days. So John and Paul were listening to essentially black music, but it had some racial integration as well. But I should point out, and this is a crucial factor to all of this, is that we now live in the information age. So whatever you want to find out, you just, you know, type into a search engine and click, and you've got your answer, more or less, or you've got something anyway. In those days, these guys knew nothing. That was a record, yeah. And that's all it was. It was a record. You could go and buy it in the shops, or you could maybe hear it on the radio, but it came with no information whatsoever. So they didn't know who the Del Vikings were or what their racial profile was or anything. They just knew it was a sound. And all these teenagers in the 50s and indeed into the 60s as well, they fell in love with the sound before they found out who these guys were. But it happened to be a black sound, and that was the best. Gonna tell Aunt Mary about Uncle John. He claimed he has a misery, but he's having a lot of fun. Oh, baby, yes, baby, woo, baby, having me some fun.
So in 1956, the year before they actually met, there's in your book, Mark, about this school friend of John who went to Amsterdam and bought Long Tall Sally. It was on a quarry bank a school trip, but he bought a 78 in Amsterdam and brought it back. Lennon was obviously obsessed with Elvis at the time, but then he said to him, come and listen to this. I'll play you something that will blow your mind. And he said it's the first time, Lennon admitted, the first time he'd ever been speechless after hearing a record. How did you research that?
That was a boy who was, I think, at Dovedale School with John Lennon and then graduated to Quarry Bank. They both went to the grammar school, Quarry Bank. So he was aware of John Lennon throughout all of his school years. John was the bad boy at the grammar school. You know, he and his mate Pete Shotton were the disruptors. Parents had always warned their children to keep away from that Lennon because he'll get you into trouble. But he was obviously a magnetic personality, and Michael Hill was around him, and I don't think they were super close, but they were close enough. And then he went on that school trip to Amsterdam and went into a record shop and came out with this 78 on a Belgian record label called Ronix. Here it is. That is the record. It's got Long Tall Sally on one side and Slipping and Sliding on the other. This is a second copy I bought on eBay because the first copy, I could hear it when I shook the box when it arrived. It arrived in 100 pieces. Not a good sound when you're buying a 78. But I've got another one. There aren't that many around, but it is I just had to have it. That is the record that turned John Lennon on to not only Little Richard, but to the notion of this music being sung by black musicians, by black artists, because Elvis was the king and Elvis was white. And they knew enough about Elvis to know what he looked like. They'd seen a picture in the Daily Mirror or the New Musical Express, and that was about it. So they go back to this Michael Hill's got the record, tells John, I've got this amazing record. They go back to his house, I think on Rose Lane, in kind of Allerton around Penny Lane area. And John is floored, completely speechless by both Long Tall Sally and Slippin' and Sliding. And then someone in the room says that he's black. And John just, what? He's black? It's just like these people didn't have a skin color. They were just singers. And then suddenly, oh, yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. And that was a complete eye opener. What he said was, this is John speaking to the journalist Maureen Cleave. I didn't know Negroes sang, because Negroes was the word then. It wasn't in any way offensive. It was just the word of the day. So Elvis was white and Little Richard was black. Thank you, God, I said. And I thought about it for days at school, the labels of the records. One, Little Richard was yellow and Elvis Presley was blue. Now, that's the Elvis Presley. That is not actually an Elvis record, but that was the Elvis record. On that label, I mean, HMV, blue. So John's thinking, Little Richard's yellow and he's black, and Elvis Presley's white and he's blue, and this is turning over around in his head. And he said, somebody said that the blacks gave the middle-class whites back their bodies. It was the only thing to get through to me out of all the things that were happening when I was 15. Rock and roll was real and everything else was unreal. And that's what he said to Rolling Stone in 1970. Mm. So immediately, any notion, I mean, racial prejudice was absolutely rife, as it always has been. But in the 1950s, post-war Britain, with the first wave of immigration from the West Indies, racism was absolutely rife in Britain. But for these guys, for whom the music was the thing, it disappeared. Because they were their heroes. It transcended it, but also these guys were their heroes. You know, I mean, they went to see Little Richard in The Girl Can't Help It at the Palais Deluxe, I think it was, on Lime Street. And it's just like, there he is. It's like Elvis is God and this guy's God and Chuck Berry's God. And it wasn't exclusively black and it wasn't exclusively white. They loved Jerry Lewis and they loved Little Richard. Yeah. They loved Elvis Presley and they loved Chuck Berry. The music was the thing. But the more they learned, the more they realized that their taste naturally was for black originated music. You make me dizzy, Miss Lizzie, the way you rock and roll. You make me dizzy, 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 when we do the stroll. Come on, Miss Lizzie, love me for a pro to roll. Come on, give me baby, put your little hand in mine. You make me dizzy, dizzy, dizzy. Ooh, girl, you look so fine.
I mean, they always said that they thought Elvis was black, didn't they? But their tastes overlapped, and we tend to think of Paul as being the big Little Richard fan. Where does John sit in terms of Chuck Berry? Where does he sit in their early kind of oeuvre of their music?
They loved originality. I mean, the Beatles were, in essence, as artists themselves, completely original, but they did consume all these influences. And they particularly gravitated to other people who were original. They could always spot a copy a mile away. I mean, when you're a connoisseur of something, you do form strong opinions, right? And when you're a group of 15, 16, 17, 18 year old lads, you very quickly decide what's great and what's crap, you know, and crap was the word, and they just wouldn't give it the time of day. And that basically meant excluding anything that was British, with one or two honourable exceptions like Johnny Kidd Shaking All Over and Cliff Richard's Move It. They just, anything British was, you know, soft. The real deal was American, and it didn't really matter there what colour skin you were, but that means it didn't count against you either. So they love Chuck Berry, and they love Carl Perkins, and they love Jerry Lee Lewis, and they love Lloyd Price. I mean, this is a guy that is quite obscure still, Arthur Alexander.
Yeah.
Don't know how well you can see that. This is a compilation album on the great Ace label from the 1980s, 82. That was a record. They used to go into the record shops and ask to hear records. I mean, no clicking a mouse to go on Spotify or any other streaming service. I mean, you had to make the effort.
Yeah.
And they used to go into Liverpool, had loads of record shops. In particular, there was Brian Epstein's shop, NEMS. And they would go in there and they would ask for anything that was American in origin. And they would look at the labels to see. But some labels had more original stuff than others. And one of them was Pi International, which had Arthur Alexander's record. Arthur Alexander's You Better Move On. That was the big one. And a shot of rhythm and blues. And it's just such a kind of two great sides. And they both went straight into the Beatles set. They just like played them that night. They just played it over and over in the booth and wrote down the words and tried to memorize it and played it. And they knew nothing about this guy. Nothing about him at all. He was from Alabama and he was from Sheffield, Alabama, and he was John's age. They assumed he was black because of his voice. It's got that kind of richness to it, but they really didn't know anything about him. But this record was clearly original, you know. Nobody else was making a sound like that, and they just had to have it. They just edit up, you know.
Well, if your hands start to clapping and your fingers start to popping and your feet start to moving around, and if you start to swing and sway when a band starts to play a real cool and way out sound, and if you get the can't help it and you can't sit down, you feel like you gotta move around.
Need a shot of rhythm and blues
with just a little rock and roll on the side.
You touched on Luxembourg, Mark. Where else might they hear it before they challenge? Yeah, had a go at trying to listen to it at a record shop.
There weren't many other places. I mean, some if you had a record, you go to. I mean, they would go to parties and people would take their records to a party. If you go in a secondhand record store now or a charity shop, you might find a 45 with someone's name on the label. And that was always done by kids because they would take their records to a party. And at the end of the party, they want to know which one's mine. And they can see their name on it and they take it home. Paul has said that they used to go to those parties and nick records that other people had very, very naively brought along. Yeah, they would do anything. Paul tells that story of getting on a bus with George to go to someone's house because he knew B7 on the guitar. and that was it. And George said the thing about, you know, because everything became so easily obtained in later decades, even say by the 80s and 90s, it was being forgotten that back in the 50s it was rationing and everything seemed rationed. He said, yeah, you couldn't get a cup of sugar, let alone a rock and roll record. But it meant that they had the passion of those who collect something scarce, you know. When something's so easily come by, you don't value it quite as much as if you really had to make the effort. Mm-hmm. And if fewer of you are doing it, because it's making the effort sorts out the real diehards from the easily falling away guys, you know, those who just go, I can't be bothered. Hey, mama, don't you treat me wrong. Come and love you, daddy, all night long, hey, hey, all right. See the girl with the diamond ring. She knows how to shake that thing. Gonna send you back to Arkansas. Oh, yes, ma'am. You don't do right. Don't do right. Oh, play it, boy.
Mark, there was a light entertainment show, wasn't there? You said that Paul McCartney heard Ray Charles, what did I say, jotted down the name of it, of the record, and then bought it when it came out. Then they started taking it to parties and making sure it got played all the time. So listen to this.
What Did I Say was another big one for the Beatles. Well, they weren't even the Beatles. This is 1959 we're talking about. Myth. It's a myth that the BBC didn't play any of this music, but they certainly didn't play much for reasons that are much more complicated than we've got the time to go into. But also for legitimate reasons that indicates that the way they're always being beaten up for because they weren't interested in this music, that's not the whole truth either. But nonetheless, Paul was in bed late one night listening to the BBC Light programme, and David Jacobs, who was regular presenter DJ in those days, was playing What Did I Say? And he did the cool thing of playing both sides of it because it was a part one and part two 45. You'd turn it over to carry on. And he actually did play both sides, and Paul scribbled it down and went into, was it NEMS or some, I can't remember which shop it was that he said he got it in, but he went and bought it anyway. And when they went to, I mean, it's a long track, What Did I Say? It runs about 6 minutes in total, which in those days was very long. Most pop records were 2 minutes. And when they got to Hamburg and they were playing all night long, that's not the song all night long, when they were actually having to play on stage for the whole night.
12 hours.
They would do very extended versions of What Did I Say, you know, like 20, 25 minutes, half an hour or whatever, because what else was there to do when you've done everything you know? You might as well do a very, very long What Did I Say. Ray Charles was a big influence. There were so many of them. There's a guy called James Ray, had a record out called If You Gotta Make a Fool of Somebody. That's the one I was thinking of earlier when I said it was on Pi International, not the Arthur Alexander record. But James Ray, If You Gotta Make a Fool of Somebody, was just like the sound that they wanted to have. I asked Paul in 1987, when I first interviewed him, what sound the Beatles were trying to get before they broke through. And he said, if the Beatles ever wanted a sound, it was R&B. That's what we used to listen to. That's what we used to like. That's what we wanted to be. Black. That was basically it. Arthur Alexander. It came out whiter because it always does. We're white and we're just young Liverpool musicians. We didn't have any finesse to actually sound black. So, but if they could have done, they would have done. And there are attempts by the Beatles, like on the With the Beatles album, where they're not exactly trying to sound black, but they're certainly so heavily influenced by that music that what they're writing is in the same vogue. And in a sense, it's John trying to be Smokey Robinson, say.
Mark, didn't Little Richard, when he saw them at the New Brighton, he was asked to go in by Brian Epstein. It was the, Billy J. Kramer's manager was asked to go in and ask Little Richard what he thought of the Beatles. And he said something like, I thought those guys were black listening to them.
Yes, which was the highest compliment that they could possibly have had. I mean, they themselves used that in marketing for just a little while, that Little Richard, the great Little Richard, had said this about them, that they actually did sound black. New Brighton Tower Ballroom, that was a momentous night in the formation of what became known as Merseybeat and the rise of the Beatles. Yeah.
Within that night, Mark, there's that fantastic photograph taken afterwards of the Beatles with Little Richard and Joe Ancra from The Chants, Sugar Dee and Derry Wilkie. Was there much connection with the black music scene in Liverpool at that time with the Beatles?
There was hardly any black music scene in Liverpool then. I mean, Derry Wilkie was an original from the late 50s. He was in... The Beatles, I always think, were in the second wave of the Liverpool groups that were coming through. If you count a wave as just being 18 months to 2 years, the Beatles surfaced in 60, 61. And there'd been a scene from about 58, and Derry Wilkie had been in the first vanguard of it. And he had a group called Derry and the Seniors, which was a play on Danny and the Juniors, the American group Danny and the Juniors. And Derry was, you know, an authentic black guy from Liverpool 8. But he was the only one, really. Then in 62, there was this vocal group called The Shades. They became The Chants. At the time when that picture was taken, they were just in transition from The Shades to The Chants. And they were more of a vocal group in the kind of doo-wop style. They didn't play any instruments. They would sing at the microphone, and they needed backing. And there were a handful of occasions when the Beatles actually did back them. No photographs, unfortunately. We've got that one picture from New Brighton Tower with Little Richard, but when the Beatles were backing The Chants, or The Shades, as they became The Chants, sadly no pictures have surfaced of that, and it would be a great thing to see. They were doing things like Gene Chandler's Duke of Earl, which was a number that they liked to do. You can, you know, it's a vocal number, essentially, but they needed some backing. And then people say Brian Epstein, the Beatles manager, managed The Chants. I've never seen any evidence of that, actually, in reality. But he did look out for them to an extent. And in 1964, he booked them into some shows in London, and the Beatles did shows with The Chants and a group called The Harlems, who were another British black vocal group, because Brian Epstein was also, like the Beatles, you know, they turned him on to all this music, and he quickly came to hear what was authentic and what wasn't, and that meant, you know, the American stuff was authentic, really. So But the amazing thing is that Liverpool, these groups in Liverpool, they were all into their rock and roll and their R&B, but the audiences were almost entirely white because of the ghettoisation that existed in those days. The black district up in Upper Parliament Street and Toxteth around Liverpool 8, they didn't really get out of their zone very much at all. I mean, people told me that you hardly ever saw them in the city centre. And I asked Sam Leach once if black people ever went to see the Beatles, or indeed any of the other groups that there were. And he said, hardly ever. You never saw a black face in the Cavern, which was so sad because on stage they're revering all this music. But, you know, life was much more divided then. We didn't have the integration then that we've become more familiar with since.
Did go to Lord Woodbine's club, didn't he, on Upper Parliament Street? I mean, for three young white lads to actually go there and to allegedly back a stripper playing a background music, I mean, that's really a situation which you wouldn't expect in those days. Can you explain what really happened?
Yeah, well, the Beatles first came upon, I keep saying the Beatles, I mean, they weren't really the Beatles yet. They were just kind of becoming Beatles very slowly. But as kids from the Liverpool Institute and the which Paul and George were at, and the art school which John and Stuart were at, they used to go into the Jacaranda coffee bar in Slater Street. And that was run by one of the city's few beatniks, Alan Williams. And his wife Beryl, and they had suffered quite a lot of racial prejudice themselves because Beryl was of Chinese origin. Though born in Liverpool, her parents were Chinese, and Alan Williams told me they used to get spat at and things like that in the street. But they stuck to their guns and they opened this coffee bar and it became the hangout place for everybody. And they booked Caribbean Steel Band for the basement. And that was the Royal Caribbean Steel Band, and that was Lord Woodbine. And Woody, as he was affectionately known, Harold Phillips was his real name, and Alan Williams were great friends. And they were entrepreneurs together, and they opened a dingy little illegal strip club just off Upper Parliament Street on Kimberley Street. And they got in this stripper in about July 1960, who insisted that she wasn't going to strip to records like other strippers had. She would only strip to live backing. And Williams, who would have wanted to pay them very little, and turned to the Beatles, who weren't expecting much, and who were kicking around with nothing to do. And so they spent a few days backing this stripper, whose name may have been Janice, but maybe not. And they backed her. So they knew Woodbine and they knew Williams. And the two of them really cooked up this whole Hamburg experience, which without which probably we wouldn't be having this conversation now, because Hamburg is the great, for the Beatles, it's the great fuse of all their talents and ambition and their desire to play all coming into play at the same time. And Williams drove them over in this little minibus that he had, and Woodbine did some of the driving as well. So it was kind of a black and white enterprise that got the Beatles off to Hamburg. And there's the picture of them stopping at the War Memorial in Arnhem in Northern Holland en route to Hamburg. And Woody's in the picture, and Alan and Beryl. And four of the Beatles, but not John, and Pete, who was born in India. So there's actually quite a cosmopolitan mix there. And the Beatles themselves, of course, heavily Irish background. So there's a real melting pot. And that was the great thing about this music that they all wanted to play, was that it did encourage a lot of them coming together of disparate people in getting it all together. A bad little kid moving to my neighborhood. He's a bad boy. He won't do nothing right. His report card don't look so good. He's a bad boy. He don't want to go to school and learn to read and write. He's a bad boy. He just sits around the house and plays that rock and roll music all night. He's a bad boy. He puts some tacks in the teacher's chair.
And beyond the strip club in Liverpool, like, did they venture further into any of the social clubs in there, the shebeens in there?
Yeah, shebeen. That was a word I first read about in Alan Williams's first book, The Man Who Gave the Beatles Away. An Irish Gaelic word meaning place of illegal drinking, an illegal drinking establishment. Woody had one called the Colony Club on Berkeley Street, again, right in the heart of Toxteth, Berkeley Street. Where, incidentally, John's mother had grown up just opposite there a couple of decades earlier, which I think John would have had no idea about. But they used to go to the Colony Club and sit there and share a bottle of whiskey or whatever. And it was one of those places that was always about to get raided because it wasn't licensed. And you could drink out of hours there. Pub hours were very narrow and restricted, and you could get you could go at 1 o'clock in the morning and get a drink, but you might get raided. So that was the kind of place that Woody ran. And of course, you know, they all hung out together, and it really didn't matter. You know, I mean, these were uncool times back. I can't stress this enough. If you read the music press of the late 50s into the early 60s, big national organizations like Mecca, will be running ballrooms in cities and towns around the country with a colour bar. So if you were black and you went to go in, you'd be refused admission. We had no Race Relations Act in those days. That didn't come in until later in the 60s. Butlins, the holiday camp where so many people went, particularly working class people, they were always denying that they had a colour bar, but they did. I mean, that's why they were having to deny it so often, because actually there was one. And, you know, Ringo grew up at Butlins, in a sense, playing with Roy Storm and the Hurricanes. He wouldn't have wanted there to be a colour bar, but there was a colour bar because that was the way it was run. And so you've got to take a hat off to any white people who were prepared to forsake all of that and just hang out with the people that they wanted to hang out with, rather than, you know, abide by, you know, run the risk of people's criticism. You know, they never cared what people thought, and that was very important to who they were and what they did. John had a great friend at art school who had a kind of Middle Eastern and Far Eastern origins, but he certainly looked like he was Indian. Jeff Muhammad, his name was, and he and John were super close pals. So, you know, it really... These were rare guys to whom these things didn't matter. Three cool cats. Three cool cats. Parked on the corner in a beat-up car. Dividing up a nickel candy bar. Talking all about how sharp they are. These three cool cats. Handbag connection is pivotal in the story of the Beatles, but it involves Derry Wilkie and an appearance or a cancelled concert summer season with Derry Wilkie, and Alan Williams was representing them at the time. Could you talk us through how that came about and how the handbag connection was came about through that cancellation? How did being that Hamburg was so essential to the Beatles' development, it's an interesting thing to consider how it actually happened. And it all happened because of the Royal Caribbean Steel Band, who were the the resident group in the little basement downstairs at the Jacaranda coffee bar. Suddenly Williams came in one day and they weren't there, and they kind of disappeared. And it turned out that they had been lured to Hamburg by some German bar owner who had been in the Jacaranda and said, yeah, you guys play good music. Why don't you come and play in my bar? And they disappeared and went off to Hamburg. And I think they must have sent a postcard back to say where they were. So Alan Williams in particular, who was always an operator for, had a sharp eye for opportunities to open clubs. He was very enthused about clubs, was Alan. And he and Woody went on a businessman's flight to Amsterdam for a weekend. You can imagine what kind of a weekend that would have been. And then they took off on their own beyond Amsterdam, and they went into, they got the train into Hamburg. They gravitated to, not exactly to the red light district, but to the street where all the sailors' bars were, which was nearby, the Große Freiheit, and went into a bar there. And Alan Williams had brought a tape with him from Liverpool of different acts, not just rock and roll acts, but anybody that he kind of could claim to have represented, singers and so on, and tried to sell the notion of exporting music to this bar owner, Bruno Koschmider. And the tape got mangled, this is a long story, but the tape got mangled somehow along the way and it turned out to be unplayable. So Williams tried his best to sell them by word, but it was difficult. And that seemed to be the end of that, until a different Williams endeavor came into view, which was that he had an association with the great impresario of the day of the British rock and roll era, Larry Parnes. Larry Parnes, who had discovered and renamed the likes of Tommy Steele, Billy Fury, Marty Wilde, Vince Eager, and so on. And he got, I think it was Derry and the Seniors, to a contract to back, I think, Billy Fury in a summer season on Great Yarmouth Pier. This is all, this is the pre-Beatles world of British rock and roll. And it fell through at the last minute. They'd all given up their jobs to go and do it, and then it fell through. And Williams knew he had to do something for them. So heroically, he piles them all into his minibus and drives 200 miles from Liverpool down to London to see if he can get them on at the Two Eyes Coffee Bar. Now, the Two Eyes Coffee Bar was famous in those days for having been the place where Tommy Steele was discovered and then Cliff Richard. So it was like the cavern of its day. You know, if you wanted to be discovered, you went to the Two Eyes. So he goes to the Two Eyes with Derry and the Seniors, puts them on stage, and who should be there but this guy from the bar in Hamburg, Bruno Koschmider. By complete chance, he's there.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, and they do a deal right then and there for Derry and the Seniors to go to Hamburg and play at the Kaiser Keller Bar, which I think begins in July 1960. And it goes so well that Koschmider gets in touch and says, I've got a second bar. Would you send another group? And it wasn't always going to be the Beatles, but by a process of elimination and other groups being unable or undesirous of going, the Beatles went and history was changed.
Yeah, out in Hamburg, although John and Paul were building their repertoire of original material, they were primarily a covers band, weren't they still? What sort of material were they playing out there?
Well, it was a great shock to the Beatles because Alan Williams had been getting them some engagements in June, July 1960. And they would play up to 2 hours, but actually in reality less than that, usually at places over the water from Liverpool on the Wirral. But they didn't really have a lot of stage experience. They'd been kicking around since 57, but they hadn't been on stage a huge amount. And they got to the Indra and they were being asked to play anything between 4.5 to 6 hours a night, 6 nights a week. And that taxed them. So what do we know? What can we play? I mean, important thing about the Beatles and their mentality right from this very moment, though, is that they took it upon themselves not to repeat themselves. Now, they were playing in bars. These weren't concerts. So very few people, if anybody, was ever there for all of it. It was a bar. You'd go in, you'd have a drink, there'd be a group on stage, you might pay them attention, you might just carry on your conversation. You finish your drink and go. So very few people would have been there the whole time, but on the basis that somebody might, Paul, I think, was the driver of this, and brilliant it was. So said, well, we won't repeat ourselves, so no one will hear us do the same song twice. They won't come in and say, didn't they do that one earlier, because we won't have done it earlier. So they had to rack their brains for everything they knew. They would do everything on the first Elvis LP, everything on the first Carl Perkins LP, everything on the first Chuck Berry LP, whatever they could remember. And they used to rearrange old standards like, I think they even did It's a Long Way to Tipperary. I mean, they would just rock up anything, basically. Now, remember that in the Beatles' minds, rock and roll was the name for this music in its totality. So when you've got the first Elvis record, they're not all like Blue Suede Shoes. He's doing I Forgot to Remember to Forget, which is a country song, or he's whatever. You know, he's doing a range of music, but it was called a rock and roll LP. So in the Beatles' minds, it was all rock and roll. And so anything was fair game. I mean, they loved doing Gene Vincent's version of the Wizard of Oz song Over the Rainbow, for example. And because Gene had done it, it was okay for them to. So you get Paul singing Somewhere Over the Rainbow, but with a kind of Gene Vincent backing, because it was rock and roll. And that's what you could do. So they were hardly playing their own songs. They were. It was almost entirely covers. And it was anything, but it was primarily black. So it was everything they knew of Chuck Berry and everything they knew of Little Richard. Who was the other guy? Larry Williams. Larry Williams was another. He was on the specialty label in America. Same as Little Richard. He did Slow Down and Dizzy Miss Lizzy and Bad Boy and Boney Maroney and all those kind of songs. So they would just do everything. When they played the Top Ten Club in 1961, they would have to do 7 to 8 hours a night, 7 nights a week. So this was an insane amount of stage experience for them.
Eight days a week.
Yeah, I mean, an insane amount of stage experience for them. So they came back to Liverpool at the end of their first visit to Hamburg. No one in Liverpool knew who they were because they hadn't played in Liverpool. They'd only played over the water. And that was a few months earlier. And they were billed as the Beatles from Hamburg. And so everyone assumed they were German. And, you know, you speak good English, don't you? And well, we only live down the road, you know. But, and that was it. I mean, they were completely tight and together and professional. That's the other thing about the Liverpool music scene, is that it had enough venues to support a number of bands being entirely professional. Didn't have to have a day job because they could earn enough money at night. And that was another great accelerator of how it all unfolded. Come on, pretty baby, won't you walk with me? Come on, pretty baby, won't you talk with me? Come on, pretty baby, I'll give you one more chance. Try to save our romance. Slow down.